battle field. Jeremy, thanks for joining us.
Thanks for having me.
So you have criticized the administration's efforts to normalize and legitimize covert ops. Do you think they've been successful in that effort?
Well, I mean, yes. I think Barack Obama, because of who he is, the Nobel Peace Prize winner, a constitutional lawyer by training, has been able to sell particularly liberals on the idea that this is a smarter way of waging war. Mm-hmm. I mean, in fact, there's very little that's new in war except technology. And I think because of the debates that the use of drones inspire in this country, there's been a finer point on it. But in reality, the U.S. has always been in the business of assassination. But Obama really is the first president in modern times to argue that the U.S. Not only has the right to do it, but is right to do it. And much of the world disagrees with that. But he really has convinced liberals largely that this is a smart policy.
Yeah, Hugo, we had last week a family from North Waziristan, and they had lost their grandmother in a U.S. drone strike, a drone strike that remains unacknowledged by the U.S. government. No reparations have been made to the family. They're deeply in debt because of medical expenses. They testified in Congress. I think we have a picture of what the room was like when they testified. It was basically empty. Yeah. And they're there testifying basically to an empty room. And if you look at the latest polling on drones, 66% of American respondents favor the use of drones, 16% oppose the use of drones, and 15% say they do not know enough. This issue, I think in many ways, the Obama administration has won.
Well, one for the time being. I mean, I think the truth is what I mean, it's a pretty representative picture, it's true, of that sort of, here are the stories and the questions are how many people are listening, right?
Right.
And the bigger question is, what's the story that will get people to listen, or how many stories will get people to listen? What will change the calculus in this? And it's unclear. Think of Al Gore's Inconvenient Truth and the power of that movie, 10 years ago? And how it sort of got a lot of talking in the media and seemed like a really big deal. 10 years later, how many Americans are going crazy about global warming? How much of an impact has? Not that much.
Well, and the inconvenient truth about this issue is that the Obama administration is dramatically downplaying the number of civilians they've killed.
Right. There's no information.
When journalists actually follow up, and when we go to the scene of these hits, the first time that Obama authorized a strike against Yemen in Al Majla in 2009, the White House claimed that Yemen had done the strike, and we know from the WikiLeaks cables that's a flagrant lie, that the U.S. actually was behind it. They killed 36 women and children in that strike. When I went there and interviewed survivors of it, I mean, they described this horrifying thing that happened. The U.S. still has not acknowledged that it killed all those civilians there. Because they've created a mathematical equation for determining who's a militant and who's a civilian,
right,
that always results in the number zero of civilians killed.
And B is, just in terms of the frequency of these attacks, Josh, in one three-month period, you report that American troops staged 1,700 night raids.
Right.
So we don't hear about that, but we do hear about, on Friday, a drone strike in Pakistan killed a Taliban chief, Hakimullah Massoud. That is greeted with sort of, great, I won't say celebration, but that is seen as a positive. And so the American public is frequently hears about the high priority targets that are eliminated, but rarely about the civilian casualties or the sort of the way that drone strikes have undermined, I think, a lot of our American credibility overseas.
Right, and I think that unanswered question about scope actually goes to the case that the White House makes for this. I think, when you say this is a smarter way of waging war, you can compare it to policy under the Bush administration after the September 11th attacks, where we engaged in two full-scale ground wars in Iraq and Afghanistan, putting well over 100,000 American troops on the ground and probably leading to hundreds of thousands of deaths in Iraq due to the ensuing chaos and civil war. So this is a strategy that has a much smaller footprint that I have to assume involves fewer civilian deaths than something like a full-scale
boots
invasion.
On the ground.
Right.
Well, but civilian deaths, too. I mean, we're not in the hundreds of thousands like they were killed in Iraq. I mean, that's true.
And so the question is, if military interventions of this sort really are necessary, and I think that's an open question, isn't this a smarter and less...
And that's a very big question,
right,
whether or not military interventions like this are necessary.
I mean, first of all, we can't let Obama off the hook on Afghanistan. Obama dramatically escalated the conventional war there, deployed tens of thousands of additional U.S. troops. There were massive airstrikes at the beginning of Obama's administration. He put Stanley McChrystal, who was a covert operator with JSOC, the Joint Special Operations Command, in charge of an entire theater of war. And a tremendous number of civilians were killed in the very kinds of wars that you're describing there. To me, the issue isn't, because Obama's killing less civilians, therefore this is a smart policy. I think we're still in a situation where we're making more new enemies than we are killing actual terrorists in these operations, not just because of civilians being killed, but because many people have the perception that we are a gratuitous adversary because we're bombing villages and going into countries without a declared war and conducting these military operations.
I'd like to ask Jeremy a question. So as you go around talking about your movie, talking about your book, and talking to people out there in the country, where do you see the sort of tide turning? You know, the stories are now beginning to get out there about these bombings, about these things, but where is there a foothold of sort of popular opinion in this country that looks like it could be changing?
I mean, I think one of the interesting things with the rise of sort of the Tea Party, but also the anti-war, more principled libertarians, sort of converging their interests with some of the more left anti-war folks, I think the 2016 election is going to be very fascinating because of this issue. My sense is that Obama sort of convinced a lot of liberals to check their consciences at the coat room of his presidency on many of these issues. And I think the next time a Republican is in office and tries to assert the right to do some of the very things Obama did, that some of those people will find their conscience again.
I think the question is also, what is the sort of as the president said in his second inaugural, the war is coming to an end. And that is the fundamental question here, right? JSOC has gone from fewer than 2,000 troops before 9/11 to as many as 25,000 today. I think you quote a JSOC source saying, we've created one hell of a hammer, and for the rest of our lives, we'll be looking for nails.
Right. I mean, Obama, you know, much of the focus was on Beyonce and the lip-syncing question at that inauguration, but that day, Obama authorized a drone strike, the day he's saying we can't be in a state of perpetual war. John Brennan, who's like the assassination czar, created the disposition matrix, which is going to ensure that this policy continues.
And let's also keep in mind that second inaugural was praised for being a return to progressive values in many ways. Yeah. So it underscores the sort of presidency in the crosshairs between a national security policy that is in many ways a continuation of the Bush administration and a desire domestically to turn the page to a much more progressive, far-reaching.
Well, I mean, I imagine Dick Cheney like fishing there in Wyoming on his little boat saying, you know, thank God that Obama did this because it cleaned it up for the next time they're in office. But a lot of this is going to continue because of who Obama is.
It is a story without end as yet. Jeremy Scahill, Dirty Wars is available on iTunes as well as in select screenings across the country. Jeremy Scahill, thank you as always for your time.
Thanks for having me back.
Thank you.